From the sands of one of the world's driest deserts, a long-lost civilization is coming back to life. More than 2,000 years ago, a peaceful culture grew and thrived here, in one of the most inhospitable regions on the planet. The people were called Nazca. They lived in Peru on an arid, harsh strip of land and survived despite severe droughts, earthquakes, and murderous flash floods. The capital city of Cahuachi, built at the crescent of a fertile river valley, was the center of their universe and the home of their gods. What carried them into oblivion, what caused their capital to fall into ruins, has remained a mystery for centuries. Now, little by little, the painstaking work of archaeologists is bringing this ancient civilization back to life. Discoveries made here may also hold the key to the Nazca lines, as yet inexplicable drawings in the middle of the desert. An immense network of huge, yet geometrically perfect designs, completely visible only from the sky. Unique creations whose meaning has continued to entice and escape the best of science. After 2,000 years of silence, what remains of this mysterious and forgotten people? In the south of Peru, a dusty track along the Nazca River, between the Andes and the Pacific Ocean. Giuseppe Orefici, director of Italy's pre-Columbian Archaeological Research Center, heads the Nazca project. For 17 years now, he's been tirelessly exploring the remains of Cahuachi. The site is huge, almost 10 square miles. It's a ghostly place, covered with sand and alluvial deposits. The Nazca mystery affects all those who come close. Rounded hills hide the sharp edges of the structures which made Cahuachi one of the most impressive cities in pre-Columbian America. Of these buildings, the Great Pyramid is perhaps the most imposing of all. The great temple, whose staircase led down towards the river, was here. Between these buildings, corridors, terraces, and squares, a whole city is gradually emerging under the archaeologists' careful hands. For Orefici, the task is equal to the size of the site. Colossal, but fascinating, and uncertain. For centuries, the location has been pillaged by shameless treasure hunters who have shown no respect for the bodies in the many tombs found here. They've taken away much of the history and left the rest to bleach in the sun. Stripped of their riches and gift offerings and abandoned to the relentless sands, hundreds of silent witnesses point to the enormity of the archaeological task here and the need to act before more is lost. Sometimes, a startling discovery provokes the archaeologists beyond mere scientific considerations.
This is what's left after the raiders have been. Material, ropes, more textiles. There are thousands. All these abandoned relics, it's material that's lost from an historical point of view. It could have helped to reconstruct these people's past, and everything has been destroyed. The raiders' activities are nowhere near stopping. Look at this object, for example. It's a sling with a variety of colors, a ceremonial sling, very beautiful. The raiders were not interested. They prefer ceramics and the fine textiles that are very popular with international collectors. Every day information is being lost here. Every day pages of history are disappearing that can never be written again. Fortunately, the site is so big, so vast, that our work to collect whatever can be saved is not in vain. We just hope that we can continue our work and save pages and pages in Nazca's history.
Historical detectives, the archaeologists never give up on a case, whatever difficulties they may encounter. Every year for the last 17 years, Orofici has returned to continue the race to save Nazca's heritage from thieves and the ravages of time. The site is too vast to be entirely recovered at once. But season after season, scraps of history are pieced together. This year, a new site has been opened a few feet from the great temple. Beneath the sandy crust, the old city reappears. As the team digs, they penetrate the different layers of Cahuachi's past. From the surface layers, dating from the 4th century, down to the city's foundations a few feet below and 8 centuries before. The city was built from sun-dried clay bricks. It was destroyed many times through flooding, earthquakes, or at the whims of the priests who governed here. Each time, Cahuachi was rebuilt on its own ruins. Each rebirth was celebrated with various offerings placed in the foundations of the new constructions. And so the Nazca world is gradually coming to light. An immense city, it was occupied only by priests and devoted to a cult of gods. Not a single trace of ordinary daily activity has ever been found here. Because the Nazcas could not write, the ceramics and textiles found here are even more valuable. Each shard of pottery is a link to the past, a window on the Nazca spirit. At the end of each day's work, the team takes the newly recovered artifacts to a laboratory and storage facility located a few miles from the site. After 17 years, the collection represents an impressive inventory of Nazca culture. Each piece is painstakingly cataloged and analyzed before being fitted into the gigantic puzzle the researchers are trying to resolve. Like an impressionist painting, a portrait of Nazca civilization takes shape. Details, however, are still veiled in mystery. The art on ceramics was exclusively for religious purposes and conformed to criteria imposed by the priests. Images represented gods. Patterns, however, were never perfect. In a world ruled by the gods, was perfection reserved only for them? Seafaring divinities reveal the story of a people born between the sea and the mountains, between the Andes and the Pacific Ocean. But many different gods reigned in the Nazca pantheon. Cats, birds, lizards, and snakes. They were gods who showered blessings on men through their noses or mouths. The symbolism is very clear. Serpentine forms and wavy tongues. What a desert people expects first from their gods is water. The Rio Grande and its tributaries were the Nazca's Nile. Apart from extremely rare rains, which normally have catastrophic consequences, drought here is the rule, and irrigation a necessity. The irrigation system invented by the Nazcas remains as a testament to their technological acumen. Designed with easy access for cleaning purposes, it is part of an intricate system of waterworks. Canals and filtering galleries called poquillos are used to funnel underground water sources from the Andes. Unmatched in pre-Columbian America, this network still irrigates the whole region. In thanks to their gods, the Nazcas built pyramids on the edge of the desert, now half hidden by the sand. These symbols of greatness beckon scientists and beg to be explored. At the base camp, Giuseppe Orefici holds a weekly meeting with his team. The weather is changing. The team will have to increase the pace.
We are together here after 1 month's work, more or less, and we have to bear one very important thing in mind. After 17 years of excavations here at Kawachi, the 71 sites that have been opened up only represent 1% of the whole site. So even after 17 years, it's still difficult to speak about Kawachi. The climatic conditions and the effects of El Niño have made themselves felt a lot here, this year and last year, and we don't know how things will be next month. Consequently, I hope you understand the efforts we have to make now to finish this year's work as quickly as possible and with the best possible results. That's all now. Thanks very much, everyone, and work well.
Work continues to go well. The team has cleared an extensive area to allow a detailed topographical study. As new areas are discovered, a small portion of the old city reveals itself. Professor Orefici is abruptly summoned to the site just before noon. In sector Y16, a well has been opened, perhaps a tomb. To the archaeologist's surprise, It appears to be blocked by bundles of textiles.
There's a lot of them.
The tension mounts quickly as more are found. The well contains many more textiles than it was first thought, and they're apparently of surprising quality. One of the specialists is intrigued by the first sample, a piece decorated with tiny feathers.
It appears to have been cut out. It's been blackened, but not burned. This is probably not a tomb. If there is one, it'll be lower down.
Oh, fantastico. Dios mio.
In the middle of the afternoon, the wind kicks up, but the work must go on. The textiles must be removed before raiders learn of the discovery and come to rob the site. The team must act quickly.
Otra persona? Aquí, aquí.
I've never seen anything like it. So far, we've got 28 pieces of cloth, and this is only the first part. We are now getting to the second lot. All these textiles belong to people of high social standing. They are decorated with divinities and ornithomorphic designs, that is to say, painted birds.
A total of 63 bundles of cloth are recovered that night by the archaeologists. It's the first time painted textiles have been found here. There are many unanswered questions. The textiles appear to be from different eras. Some are much, much older than others. Why would material from different periods be buried together? Analysis of the finds will take months of hard work.
We have to try to save all the information contained in the textiles. Many pieces have been darkened by organic material inside, and by the humidity they've been in contact with.
Only a very few such examples exist. Their scarcity is a question of age. The oldest textiles are from the beginning of Nazca civilization. Organic traces show that they have been in contact with corpses and were used as shrouds. Orefici concludes that they have been recovered, gathered into bundles, and ritually reburied, perhaps at a time of change in the religious or ceremonial practices. The mystery only adds to the fascination. These textiles will now be added to the laboratory museum. Even after so many centuries, Nazca art, cotton thread joining llama and alpaca-based wool craftsmanship, is sound. The unusual variety of colors and embroidery shine out under the Peruvian sun as if it were yesterday. This cotton and wool coat decorated with a flying cat and a variety of Nazca religious figures, might have been part of the splendor of Cahuachi's ceremonies over 2,000 years ago. Even older, this funeral cloth, made up of 7 strips and squares sewn together, might have covered the tomb of a woman who died 350 years before Christ. Sewn with cactus needles, these 3-dimensional hummingbirds decorated the border of a ceremonial coat. The colors came from vegetable, animal, and insect pigments, such as crushed caterpillar fixed in human urine. This ceremonial costume is one of the jewels of the collection. On the central strip is a collection of Nazcan divinities. Around them, the people are in procession. Over 500 miniature figures, each one different, even down to their facial expressions. They carry flutes or maracas or fans. One can almost feel the Nazcas come to life with their painted faces and richly colored costumes, singing and dancing before their gods. The great city of Cahuachi lies deserted, hiding beneath a blanket of clay and sand. 1,700 years ago, after 6 centuries of uncontested domination, the Nazca's religious capital fell dramatically into oblivion, almost as if it had been buried alive.
What happened at Cahuachi? Between 300 and 350 AD, there were 2 important events. First, there was a major flood, which was particularly serious. We have found evidence of this in all of our excavations. Then there was an earthquake. An earthquake that would destroy all the temples. We found dead bodies under the walls which collapsed. The Nazca's religion no longer functioned. Their gods and ceremonial centers no longer functioned. It was then that they abandoned the city. But before they left, because everything was a ritual for them, the whole culture was based on religion. The Nazcas completely buried the ruins under piles of earth. Look at the remains on the highest part of the site, and you'll see that they are covered with a layer of clay that was brought to the top of the embankment by man. That's what makes this a sacred site. Everything, absolutely everything to be found under our feet was deliberately covered by the Nazcans themselves.
1,700 years ago, the city of Cahuachi disappeared, buried by the very people who built it. The Nazcas would only survive their capital by another 200 or 300 years before they were assimilated by the Huari, an Andean people with whom they'd always interacted. Before the Inca, the Huari dominated all of Peru. The fall of Cahuachi led to the decline of its gods and the removal of the priests' power. As a feudal regime took shape, the old gods disappeared, and the faces of men began to appear on the ceramics. In the Nazca conscience, man was freed and would now occupy a more central position. The wind has dropped over the excavation site and work can begin again. In an intermediate layer between 2 phases of Cahuachi's history, The archaeologists have uncovered the mummy of a young llama. The animal has been sacrificed. This may be a tomb that has escaped the robbers. Next, a collection of pottery comes to the surface, revealing the presence of tombs. This pottery was used as covers for the funeral wells where the dead were buried. With lower limbs folded under the chin, the dead were buried in a fetal position, perhaps as a reminder of the origins of life, or because it was a comfortable position to be in for a long journey. A second tomb reveals a mummy still covered with its shroud. The archaeologists try to free it, but 15 centuries of immobilized waiting make the maneuver somewhat risky. The team's anthropologists decide to make an initial analysis in situ. Dr. Brian Harrison of the University of Oregon.
It's clearly the skeleton of a young woman. You can tell by the shape of the pelvis. She's an adult, but she's not very old, I think. I have not seen any arthritis on the joints. This excellent preservation of organic material here. This is a fantastic sight. The hair is in perfect condition. We can get a lot of information about the population that lived here 1,000 years ago. One way we can tell that she was in good health is by the condition of her teeth. There's no lines, the enamel is very strong. So she was a healthy young woman, probably 20 to 25 years old. So the people we know were fairly short, long black hair, probably muscular from working very hard. And we have evidence from the skeletal materials, particularly the teeth, that they were very healthy people. And also from those same skeletons, we see no evidence of trauma. There was no warfare here.
After so long, such an encounter is a miracle. The body was buried without any particular preparation. Only natural mummification could have preserved the body in this way. The area's sand is rich in salts and nitrates, and without humidity. These mummies are a mine of information for anthropologists. Professor Andrea Drusini from the University of Padua has been able to study 550 individuals so far.
As with every population, we have come across various diseases: anemia, traces of malnutrition, children's illnesses, and other infectious diseases. According to statistics concerning this population, it can be said that their life expectancy was around 37-38 years. This is not significantly different than 19th century Europe, where the average lifespan was 42 years, and yet there is almost 2,000 years difference between the two populations.
Soon after work resumes on the site of the tombs, a new body appears. Unlike the others, it is lying on the ground in a horizontal position. Dr. Dracini now assumes the role of coroner. The skeleton's hands are tied in front of the body.
Questa posizione è molto inusuale.
Può essere naturale questa posizione?
No. Probabilmente si è trattato di un'esecuzione e il corpo poi è rimasto in questa posizione.
È piegato sotto la pancia. È molto strano questo.
Secondo me c'è stato un colpo molto forte che ha praticamente fratturato la base del cranio. Però dall'andamento della frattura sembra che sia stato inferto dal davanti e non dal dietro. Come quando è appoggiata la testa, capisci? Il collo si arqua.
Ma non è fuori dal suo posto?
No, no.
Frattura ben grande.
Beh, Giuseppe, è stato un colpo proprio nella zona proprio del frontale.
Il frontale,
colpo secco proprio qua.
Che ha fracassato completamente.
Ha fracassato completamente la parte.
Il setto nasale, il maxillo facciale.
Il facciale, naso.
Il
ha fracassato proprio completamente la faccia.
Lo copriva completamente. Non è giovane?
No, ma è giovanissima.
35 anni.
40 anni.
Tiene anche 40 anni. Ah.
Coprolito.
Coprolito in bocca.
This is not the first time that coprolite or fossilized human excrement has been found here in the mummies' mouths. The meaning of such a practice, however, has not been determined.
In a case like this one, we don't know the meaning that placing excrement in an individual's mouth might have had. Perhaps it was a mark of disrespect or a punishment. We just don't know.
In total, 7 mummies are taken from their tombs that day, providing a much larger sample for the anthropologists to work on. The sample provides outsiders a view into another world, fascinating, yet very different from our own, and somewhat disturbing. Over 90% of the skulls studied by Professor Dracini were artificially deformed. This practice can be found in other civilizations and was probably based on certain concepts of beauty. For about a year, the heads of newborn babies were bound with tightly wrapped llama skin bindings, which forced their supple skulls to grow upwards. A short distance away in the laboratory, there are skulls with holes in the forehead, a real challenge to our imaginations. These are men's skulls, but women's and children's were also found this way, suggesting this was not a ritual of war. A rope through the hole held in place by a stick inside the skull would have allowed the heads to be carried or suspended, perhaps an offering and a sacrifice, a trophy, or a symbol of power. Sometimes the mouth is sewn up with a wooden needle or a cactus spine. Sometimes the eyes are blocked, or the tongue cut out and sewn into a little leather bag, so the dead souls cannot return to bother the living. All the iconography illustrates the importance of these practices in a civilization that was no more and no less barbaric than any other at that time. Taking advantage of the calm weather, Professor Orefici flies over the desert with his friend, Eduardo Herrán, an experienced pilot who's discovered more than 350 of the Nazca geoglyphs, perhaps the greatest enigma this people has left behind. These gigantic lines and colossal figures etched into the lunar landscape of the desert pampas range over nearly 200 square miles and are only completely visible from the air. In certain places, simple geometrical shapes overlap other more complex patterns. Quite simply, this is because the lines were drawn over a thousand-year period, and the artists just drew new designs over old tracks. In order to establish the chronology, specialists compare the patterns with the iconography of the ceramics and textiles. In fact, the whole pantheon of these icons was recreated on a gigantic scale on the desert floor. There is the condor, the monkey, the hummingbird, lines are remarkable for their size and their number, which is constantly being re-evaluated. Eduardo is today showing his friend a set of lines he discovered a few months before. A few hours later, Orefici walks the new lines. After 2,000 years of solitude, the lines appear to be intact. Yet only the very top layer of soil has been removed. No one has maintained them. How can such a degree of conservation be explained?
To begin with, there is no agriculture here. Man has not damaged the lines, which were outside farming areas and away from any daily activity. Another explanation comes from the very nature of the soil here, which is composed of clay and gypsum. Also, thanks to the nocturnal humidity, the stones sink a little more into the soil each night. In the daytime, the soil dries in the sun, and the stones are gradually fixed even more. There is always some wind here, but it can't move stones of this size. That's why we can still see these geoglyphs after 2,000 years.
Their careful exploration of the lines goes on, following the enigmatic traces that seem to disappear into the horizon. At ground level, the overall shape is impossible to discern. When they were created, man did not yet fly. For whom did the Nazca draw these lines? In his laboratory museum, Giuseppe Orefici unveils a new model of the geoglyph site to the mayor of the town and to the Peruvian historian José Lancho Rojas. Inevitably, their conversation turns to the meaning and function of the lines.
chiesa panamericana, il lagarto, il guarango, las manos, aquí hay los otros. Este se vio bastante bien.
Most of the drawings they find are made of a single unbroken line. Could this mean something? But first of all, how did the Nazcan artists go about making these gigantic drawings in one single line and without perspective?
I think the television crew would like to make a replica of the geoglyphs, full scale on the ground, that is, not on the archaeological site, obviously. What do you think?
I have an idea.
Professor Lancho's idea is very simple. With a few assistants and some basic tools, the historian proposes to draw out on the desert floor a full-scale version of a drawing made beforehand on paper.
Yeah, ahí muere. Yeah, okay. Yeah, un ratito. Derecha, derecha, poquito. Derecha, poquito. Yeah, okay.
After multiplying the dimensions to get the desired scale, the group uses ropes and an improvised compass to etch the pattern into the ground. A few elementary notions of geometry suffice. 2,000 years ago, enlarging such a drawing would not have posed more of a problem to the Nazcan textile workers and monument and aqueduct builders than it does to Professor Lancho's team.
Sobre la línea. Tiembla más, José Luis, tiembla más. Sí, tiene, tiene. La piedra está malogrando acá.
Indeed, for Professor Lancho, the problem is not a question of how to draw the geoglyphs in the desert. It is to understand the mystery of why their creators made them at all.
At certain important dates, families would assemble on the Pampa to take part in various ceremonies organized on the geoglyphs as an offering to the gods in the heavens.
According to Professor Lancho, who now mobilizes his troops, the lines provided a kind of path that humans followed during major ceremonies. As they walked, the procession would bring the design to life before the gods. Lines became living icons, allowing the Nazca to celebrate on a vast scale the union of a people with their gods. It is December, and after 2 months of excavation work, another season in the field comes to an end. 2 months' work for a few more scraps of history, a few more pieces gleaned from the desert and correctly placed in the Cahuachi jigsaw. Exposed to the harsh winds and the burning sun, the uncovered ruins of this fragile city are beginning to crumble, and Peruvian law requires that Covachi be recovered. With heavy hearts, the archaeologists return the ancient city to its sandy bed. Year after year, they repeat a ritual which began 2,000 years ago, as Covachi is covered once more in dust. From the sands of one of the world's driest deserts, a long-lost civilization is coming back to life. More than 2,000 years ago, a peaceful culture grew and thrived here, in one of the most inhospitable regions on the planet. The people were called Nazca. They lived in Peru on an arid, harsh strip of land, and survived despite severe droughts, earthquakes, and murderous flash floods. The capital city of Cahuachi, built at the crescent of a fertile river valley, was the center of their universe and the home of their gods. What carried them into oblivion, what caused their capital to fall into ruins, has remained a mystery for centuries. Now, little by little, the painstaking work of archaeologists is bringing this ancient civilization back to life. Discoveries made here may also hold the key to the Nazca lines, as yet inexplicable drawings in the middle of the desert. An immense network of huge, yet geometrically perfect designs, completely visible only from the sky. Unique creations whose meaning has continued to entice and escape the best of science. After 2,000 years of silence, what remains of this mysterious and forgotten people? In the south of Peru, a dusty track along the Nazca River between the Andes and the Pacific Ocean. Giuseppe Orefici, director of Italy's pre-Columbian Archaeological Research Center, heads the Nazca project. For 17 years now, he's been tirelessly exploring the remains of Cahuachi. The site is huge, almost 10 square miles. It's a ghostly place, covered with sand and alluvial deposits. The Nazca mystery affects all those who come close. Rounded hills hide the sharp edges of the structures which made Cahuachi one of the most impressive cities in pre-Columbian America. Of these buildings, the Great Pyramid is perhaps the most imposing of all. The Great Temple, whose staircase led down towards the river, was here. Between these buildings, corridors, terraces, and squares, a whole city is gradually emerging under the archaeologists' careful hands. For Orofici, the task is equal to the size of the site, colossal, but fascinating and uncertain. For centuries, the location has been pillaged by shameless treasure hunters who have shown no respect for the bodies in the many tombs found here. They've taken away much of the history and left the rest to bleach in the sun. Stripped of their riches and gift offerings and abandoned to the relentless sands, hundreds of silent witnesses point to the enormity of the archaeological task here and the need to act before more is lost. Sometimes, a startling discovery provokes the archaeologists beyond mere scientific considerations.
This is what's left after the raiders have been. Material, ropes, more textiles. There are thousands. All these abandoned relics, it's material that's lost from an historical point of view. It could have helped to reconstruct these people's past, and everything has been destroyed. The raiders' activities are nowhere near stopping. Look at this object, for example. It's a sling with a variety of colors, a ceremonial sling, very beautiful. The raiders were not interested. They prefer ceramics and the fine textiles that are very popular with international collectors. Every day information is being lost here. Every day pages of history are disappearing that can never be written again. Fortunately, the site is so big, so vast, that our work to collect whatever can be saved is not in vain. We just hope that we can continue our work and save pages and pages in Nazca's history.
Historical detectives, the archaeologists never give up on a case, whatever difficulties they may encounter. Every year for the last 17 years, Orofici has returned to continue the race to save Nazca's heritage from thieves and the ravages of time. The site is too vast to be entirely recovered at once, but season after season, scraps of history are pieced together. This year, a new site has been opened a few feet from the Great Temple. Beneath the sandy crust, the old city reappears. As the team digs, they penetrate the different layers of Cahuachi's past. From the surface layers, dating from the 4th century, down to the city's foundations a few feet below and 8 centuries before. The city was built from sun-dried clay bricks. It was destroyed many times through flooding, earthquakes, or at the whims of the priests who governed here. Each time, Cahuachi was rebuilt on its own ruins. Each rebirth was celebrated with various offerings placed in the foundations of the new constructions. And so the Nazca world is gradually coming to light. An immense city, it was occupied only by priests and devoted to a cult of gods. Not a single trace of ordinary daily activity has ever been found here. Because the Nazcas could not write, the ceramics and textiles found here are even more valuable. Each shard of pottery is a link to the past, a window on the Nazca spirit. At the end of each day's work, the team takes the newly recovered artifacts to a laboratory and storage facility located a few miles from the site. After 17 years, the collection represents an impressive inventory of Nazca culture. Each piece is painstakingly cataloged and analyzed before being fitted into the gigantic puzzle the researchers are trying to resolve. Like an impressionist painting, a portrait of Nazca civilization takes shape. Details, however, are still veiled in mystery. The art on ceramics was exclusively for religious purposes and conformed to criteria imposed by the priests. Images represented gods. Patterns, however, were never perfect. In a world ruled by the gods, was perfection reserved only for them? Seafaring divinities reveal the story of a people born between the sea and the mountains, between the Andes and the Pacific Ocean. But many different gods reigned in the Nazca pantheon. Cats, birds, lizards, and snakes. They were gods who showered blessings on men through their noses or mouths. The symbolism is very clear. Serpentine forms and wavy tongues. What a desert people expects first from their gods is water. The Rio Grande and its tributaries were the Nazca's Nile. Apart from extremely rare rains, which normally have catastrophic consequences, drought here is the rule, and irrigation a necessity. The irrigation system invented by the Nazcas remains as a testament to their technological acumen. Designed with easy access for cleaning purposes, it is part of an intricate system of waterworks. Canals and filtering galleries called poquillos are used to funnel underground water sources from the Andes. Unmatched in pre-Columbian America, this network still irrigates the whole region. In thanks to their gods, the Nazcas built pyramids on the edge of the desert, now half hidden by the sand. These symbols of greatness beckon scientists and beg to be explored. At the base camp, Giuseppe Orefici holds a weekly meeting with his team. The weather is changing. The team will have to increase the pace.
We are together here after 1 month's work, more or less, and we have to bear one very important thing in mind. After 17 years of excavations here at Kawachi, the 71 sites that have been opened up only represent 1% of the whole site. So even after 17 years, it's still difficult to speak about Kawachi. The climatic conditions and the effects of El Niño have made themselves felt a lot here, this year and last year, and we don't know how things will be next month. Consequently, I hope you understand the efforts we have to make now to finish this year's work as quickly as possible and with the best possible results. That's all now. Thanks very much, everyone, and work well.
Work continues to go well. The team has cleared an extensive area to allow a detailed topographical study. As new areas are discovered, a small portion of the old city reveals itself. Professor Orefici is abruptly summoned to the site just before noon. In sector Y16, a well has been opened, perhaps a tomb. To the archaeologist's surprise, it appears to be blocked by bundles of textiles.
There's a lot of them.
The tension mounts quickly as more are found. The well contains many more textiles than it was first thought, and they're apparently of surprising quality. One of the specialists is intrigued by the first sample, a piece decorated with tiny feathers.
It appears to have been cut out. It's been blackened, but not burned. This is probably not a tomb. If there is one, it'll be lower down.
Oh, fantastic.
In the middle of the afternoon, the wind kicks up, but the work must go on. The textiles must be removed before raiders learn of the discovery and come to rob the site. The team must act quickly.
Otra persona. Aquí.
I've never seen anything like it. So far, we've got 28 pieces of cloth, and this is only the first part. We are now getting to the second lot. All these textiles belong to people of high social standing. They are decorated with divinities and ornithomorphic designs, that is to say, painted birds.
A total of 63 bundles of cloth are recovered that night by the archaeologists. It's the first time painted textiles have been found here. There are many unanswered questions. The textiles appear to be from different eras. Some are much, much older than others. Why would material from different periods be buried together? Analysis of the finds will take months of hard work.
We have to try to save all the information contained in the textiles. Many pieces have been darkened by organic material inside, and by the humidity they've been in contact with.
Only a very few such examples exist. Their scarcity is a question of age. The oldest textiles are from the beginning of Nazca civilization. Organic traces show that they have been in contact with corpses and were used as shrouds. Orefici concludes that they have been recovered, gathered into bundles, and ritually reburied, perhaps at a time of change in the religious or ceremonial practices. The mystery only adds to the fascination. These textiles will now be added to the laboratory museum. Even after so many centuries, Nazca art, cotton thread joining llama and alpaca-based wool craftsmanship, is sound. The unusual variety of colors and embroidery shine out under the Peruvian sun as if it were yesterday. This cotton and wool coat, decorated with a flying cat and a variety of Nazca religious figures, might have been part of the splendor of Cahuachi's ceremonies over 2,000 years ago. Even older, this funeral cloth, made up of seven strips and squares sewn together, might have covered the tomb of a woman who died 350 years before Christ. Sewn with cactus needles, these three-dimensional hummingbirds decorated the border of a ceremonial coat. The colors came from vegetable, animal, and insect pigments, such as crushed caterpillar fixed in human urine. This ceremonial costume is one of the jewels of the collection. On the central strip is a collection of Nazcan divinities. Around them, the people are in procession. Over 500 miniature figures, each one different, even down to their facial expressions. They carry flutes or maracas or fans. One can almost feel the Nazcas come to life with their painted faces and richly colored costumes, singing and dancing before their gods. The great city of Cahuachi lies deserted, hiding beneath a blanket of clay and sand. 1,700 years ago, after 6 centuries of uncontested domination, the Nazca's religious capital fell dramatically into oblivion, almost as if it had been buried alive.
What happened at Cahuachi? Between 300 and 350 AD, there were two important events. First, there was a major flood, which was particularly serious. We have found evidence of this in all of our excavations. Then there was an earthquake. An earthquake that would destroy all the temples. We found dead bodies under the walls which collapsed. The Nazca's religion no longer functioned. Their gods and ceremonial centers no longer functioned. It was then that they abandoned the city. But before they left, because everything was a ritual for them, the whole culture was based on religion. The Nazcas completely buried the ruins under piles of earth. Look at the remains on the highest part of the site, and you'll see that they are covered with a layer of clay that was brought to the top of the embankment by man. That's what makes this a sacred site. Everything, absolutely everything to be found under our feet was deliberately covered by the Nazcans themselves.
1700 years ago, the city of Cahuachi disappeared, buried by the very people who built it. The Nazcas would only survive their capital by another 200 or 300 years before they were assimilated by the Huari, an Andean people with whom they'd always interacted. Before the Inca, the Huari dominated all of Peru. The fall of Cahuachi led to the decline of its gods and the removal of the priest's power. As a feudal regime took shape, the old gods disappeared, and the faces of men began to appear on the ceramics. In the Nazca conscience, man was freed and would now occupy a more central position. The wind has dropped over the excavation site and work can begin again. In an intermediate layer between two phases of Cahuachi's history, the archaeologists have uncovered the mummy of a young llama. The animal has been sacrificed. This may be a tomb that has escaped the robbers. Next, a collection of pottery comes to the surface, revealing the presence of tombs. This pottery was used as covers for the funeral wells where the dead were buried. With lower limbs folded under the chin, the dead were buried in a fetal position, perhaps as a reminder of the origins of life, or because it was a comfortable position to be in for a long journey. A second tomb reveals a mummy still covered with its shroud. The archaeologists try to free it, but 15 centuries of immobilized waiting make the maneuver somewhat risky. The team's anthropologists decide to make an initial analysis in situ. Dr. Brian Harrison of the University of Oregon.
It's clearly the skeleton of a young woman. You can tell by the shape of the pelvis. She's an adult, but she's not very old, I think. I have not seen any arthritis on the joints. This excellent preservation of organic material here. This is a fantastic site. The hair is in perfect condition. We can get a lot of information about the population that lived here 1,000 years ago. One way we can tell that she was in good health is by the condition of her teeth. There's no lines. The enamel is very strong. So she was a healthy young woman, probably 20 to 25 years old. So the people we know were fairly short, long black hair, probably muscular from working very hard. And we have evidence from the skeletal materials, particularly the teeth, that they were very healthy people. And also from those same skeletons, we see no evidence of trauma. There was no warfare here.
After so long, such an encounter is a miracle. The body was buried without any particular preparation. Only natural mummification could have preserved the body in this way. The area's sand is rich in salts and nitrates, and without humidity. These mummies are a mine of information for anthropologists. Professor Andrea Drusini from the University of Padua has been able to study 550 individuals so far.
As with every population, we have come across various diseases: anemia, traces of malnutrition, children's illnesses, and other infectious diseases. According to statistics concerning this population, it can be said that their life expectancy was around 37-38 years. This is not significantly different than 19th century Europe, where the average lifespan was 42 years, and yet there is almost 2,000 years difference between the two populations.
Soon after work resumes on the site of the tombs, a new body appears. Unlike the others, it is lying on the ground in a horizontal position. Dr. Drusini now assumes the role of coroner. The skeleton's hands are tied in front of the body.
Questa posizione è molto inusuale.
Può essere naturale questa posizione?
No. Probabilmente si è trattato di un'esecuzione e il corpo poi è rimasto in questa posizione.
È piegato sotto la pancia. È molto strano questo.
Secondo me c'è stato un colpo molto forte che ha praticamente fratturato la base del cranio. Però dall'andamento della frattura sembra che sia stato inferto dal davanti e non dal dietro. Come quando è appoggiata la testa, capisci? Il collo si arqua.
Ma non è fuori del suo posto?
No, no.
Frattura ben grande.
Mentre sarebbe stato un colpo proprio nella zona proprio del frontale,
il frontale
colpo secco proprio qua.
Che ha fracassato completamente.
Ha fracassato completamente la parte.
Il setto nasale, il maxillo facciale.
Il facciale, naso.
Che
ha fracassato proprio completamente la faccia.
L'ho coperto completamente. Non è giovane?
No, no, è giovanissima.
35 anni.
40 anni.
E anche 40 anni. Aha.
Coprolito.
Coprolito in bocca.
This is not the first time that coprolite or fossilized human excrement has been found here in the mummies' mouths. The meaning of such a practice, however, has not been determined.
In a case like this one, we don't know the meaning that placing excrement in an individual's mouth might have had. Perhaps it was a mark of disrespect or a punishment, we just don't know.
In total, 7 mummies are taken from their tombs that day, providing a much larger sample for the anthropologists to work on. The sample provides outsiders a view into another world, fascinating, yet very different from our own, and somewhat disturbing. Over 90% of the skulls studied by Professor Dracini were artificially deformed. This practice can be found in other civilizations and was probably based on certain concepts of beauty. For about a year, the heads of newborn babies were bound with tightly wrapped llama skin bindings, which forced their supple skulls to grow upwards. A short distance away in the laboratory, there are skulls with holes in the forehead, a real challenge to our imaginations. These are men's skulls, but women's and children's were also found this way, suggesting this was not a ritual of war. A rope through the hole held in place by a stick inside the skull would have allowed the heads to be carried or suspended, perhaps an offering and a sacrifice, a trophy, or a symbol of power. Sometimes the mouth is sewn up with a wooden needle or a cactus spine. Sometimes the eyes are blocked, or the tongue cut out and sewn into a little leather bag, so the dead souls cannot return to bother the living. All the iconography illustrates the importance of these practices in a civilization that was no more and no less barbaric than any other at that time. Taking advantage of the calm weather, Professor Orefici flies over the desert with his friend, Eduardo Herrán, an experienced pilot who's discovered more than 350 of the Nazca geoglyphs, perhaps the greatest enigma this people has left behind. These gigantic lines and colossal figures etched into the lunar landscape of the desert Pampas range over nearly 200 square miles and are only completely visible from the air. In certain places, simple geometrical shapes overlap other more complex patterns. Quite simply, this is because the lines were drawn over a thousand-year period, and the artists just drew new designs over old tracks. In order to establish the chronology, specialists compare the patterns with the iconography of the ceramics and textiles. In fact, the whole pantheon of these icons was recreated on a gigantic scale on the desert floor. There is the condor, the monkey, the hummingbird, lines are remarkable for their size and their number, which is constantly being re-evaluated. Eduardo is today showing his friend a set of lines he discovered a few months before. A few hours later, Orefici walks the new lines. After 2,000 years of solitude, the lines appear to be intact. Yet only the very top layer of soil has been removed. No one has maintained them. How can such a degree of conservation be explained?
To begin with, there is no agriculture here. Man has not damaged the lines, which were outside farming areas and away from any daily activity. Another explanation comes from the very nature of the soil here, which is composed of clay and gypsum. Also, thanks to the nocturnal humidity, the stones sink a little more into the soil each night. In the daytime, the soil dries in the sun, and the stones are gradually fixed even more. There is always some wind here, but it can't move stones of this size. That's why we can still see these geoglyphs after 2,000 years.
Their careful exploration of the lines goes on, following the enigmatic traces that seem to disappear into the horizon. At ground level, the overall shape is impossible to discern. When they were created, man did not yet fly. For whom did the Nazca draw these lines? In his laboratory museum, Giuseppe Orefici unveils a new model of the geoglyph site to the mayor of the town and to the Peruvian historian José Lancho Rojas. Inevitably, their conversation turns to the meaning and function of the lines. Most of the drawings they find are made of a single unbroken line. Could this mean something? But first of all, how did the Nazcan artists go about making these? From the sands of one of the world's driest deserts, a long-lost civilization is coming back to life. More than 2,000 years ago, a peaceful culture grew and thrived here, in one of the most inhospitable regions on the planet. The people were called Nazca. They lived in Peru on an arid, harsh strip of land and survived despite severe droughts, earthquakes, and murderous flash floods. The capital city of Cahuachi, built at the crescent of a fertile river valley, was the center of their universe and the home of their gods. What carried them into oblivion, what caused their capital to fall into ruins, has remained a mystery for centuries. Now, little by little, the painstaking work of archaeologists is bringing this ancient civilization back to life. Discoveries made here may also hold the key to the Nazca lines, as yet inexplicable drawings in the middle of the desert. An immense network of huge, yet geometrically perfect designs, completely visible only from the sky. Unique creations whose meaning has continued to entice and escape the best of science. After 2,000 years of silence, what remains of this mysterious and forgotten people? In the south of Peru, a dusty track along the Nazca River between the Andes and the Pacific Ocean. Giuseppe Orefici, director of Italy's Pre-Columbian Archaeological Research Center, heads the Nazca project. For 17 years now, he's been tirelessly exploring the remains of Cahuachi. The site is huge, almost 10 square miles. It's a ghostly place, covered with sand and alluvial deposits. The Nazca mystery affects all those who come close. Rounded hills hide the sharp edges of the structures which made Cahuachi one of the most impressive cities in pre-Columbian America. Of these buildings, the Great Pyramid is perhaps the most imposing of all. The Great Temple, whose staircase led down towards the river, was here. Between these buildings, corridors, terraces, and squares, a whole city is gradually emerging under the archaeologists' careful hands. For Orefici, the task is equal to the size of the site, colossal, but fascinating and uncertain. For centuries, the location has been pillaged by shameless treasure hunters who have shown no respect for the bodies in the many tombs found here. They've taken away much of the history and left the rest to bleach in the sun. Stripped of their riches and gift offerings and abandoned to the relentless sands, hundreds of silent witnesses point to the enormity of the archaeological task here and the need to act before more is lost. Sometimes, a startling discovery provokes the archaeologists beyond mere scientific considerations.
This is what's left after the raiders have been material, ropes, more textiles. There are thousands. All these abandoned relics, it's material that's lost from an historical point of view. It could have helped to reconstruct these people's past, and everything has been destroyed. The raiders' activities are nowhere near stopping. Look at this object, for example. It's a sling with a variety of colors, a ceremonial sling, very beautiful. The raiders were not interested. They prefer ceramics and the fine textiles that are very popular with international collectors. Every day information is being lost here. Every day pages of history are disappearing that can never be written again. Fortunately, the site is so big, so vast, that our work to collect whatever can be saved is not in vain. We just hope that we can continue our work and save pages and pages in Nazca's history.
Historical detectives, the archaeologists never give up on a case, whatever difficulties they may encounter. Every year for the last 17 years, Orefici has returned to continue the race to save Nazca's heritage from thieves and the ravages of time. The site is too vast to be entirely recovered at once, but season after season, scraps of history are pieced together. This year, a new site has been opened a few feet from the Great Temple. Beneath the sandy crust, the old city reappears. As the team digs, they penetrate the different layers of Cahuachi's past. From the surface layers, dating from the 4th century, down to the city's foundations a few feet below, and 8 centuries before. The city was built from sun-dried clay bricks. It was destroyed many times through flooding, earthquakes, or at the whims of the priests who governed here. Each time, Cahuachi was rebuilt on its own ruins. Each rebirth was celebrated with various offerings placed in the foundations of the new constructions. And so the Nazca world is gradually coming to light. An immense city, it was occupied only by priests and devoted to a cult of gods. Not a single trace of ordinary daily activity has ever been found here. Because the Nazcas could not write, the ceramics and textiles found here are even more valuable. Each shard of pottery is a link to the past, a window on the Nazca spirit. At the end of each day's work, the team takes the newly recovered artifacts to a laboratory and storage facility located a few miles from the site. After 17 years, the collection represents an impressive inventory of Nazca culture. Each piece is painstakingly cataloged and analyzed before being fitted into the gigantic puzzle the researchers are trying to resolve. Like an impressionist painting, a portrait of Nazca civilization takes shape. Details, however, are still veiled in mystery. The art on ceramics was exclusively for religious purposes and conformed to criteria imposed by the priests. Images represented gods. Patterns, however, were never perfect. In a world ruled by the gods, was perfection reserved only for them? Seafaring divinities reveal the story of a people born between the sea and the mountains, between the Andes and the Pacific Ocean. But many different gods reigned in the Nazca pantheon. Cats, birds, lizards, and snakes. They were gods who showered blessings on men through their noses or mouths. The symbolism is very clear. Serpentine forms and wavy tongues. What a desert people expects first from their gods is water. The Rio Grande and its tributaries were the Nazca's Nile. Apart from extremely rare rains, which normally have catastrophic consequences, drought here is the rule, and irrigation a necessity. The irrigation system invented by the Nazcas remains as a testament to their technological acumen. Designed with easy access for cleaning purposes, it is part of an intricate system of waterworks. Canals and filtering galleries called poquillos are used to funnel underground water sources from the Andes. Unmatched in pre-Columbian America, this network still irrigates the whole region. In thanks to their gods, the Nazcas built pyramids on the edge of the desert, now half hidden by the sand. These symbols of greatness beckon scientists and beg to be explored. At the base camp, Giuseppe Orefici holds a weekly meeting with his team. The weather is changing. The team will have to increase the pace.
We are together here after 1 month's work, more or less, and we have to bear one very important thing in mind. After 17 years of excavations here at Kawachi, the 71 sites that have been opened up only represent 1% of the whole site. So even after 17 years, it's still difficult to speak about Kawachi. The climatic conditions and the effects of El Niño have made themselves felt a lot here, this year and last year, and we don't know how things will be next month. Consequently, I hope you understand the efforts we have to make now to finish this year's work as quickly as possible and with the best possible results. That's all now. Thanks very much, everyone, and work well.
Work continues to go well. The team has cleared an extensive area to allow a detailed topographical study. As new areas are discovered, a small portion of the old city reveals itself. Professor Orefici is abruptly summoned to the site just before noon. In sector Y16, a well has been opened, perhaps a tomb. To the archaeologist's surprise, it appears to be blocked by bundles of textiles.
There's a lot of them.
The tension mounts quickly as more are found. The well contains many more textiles than it was first thought, and they're apparently of surprising quality. One of the specialists is intrigued by the first sample, a piece decorated with tiny feathers.
It appears to have been cut out. It's been blackened, but not burned. This is probably not a tomb. If there is one, it'll be lower down.
Oh, fantastico. Dios mio.
In the middle of the afternoon, the wind kicks up, but the work must go on. The textiles must be removed before raiders learn of the discovery and come to rob the site. The team must act quickly.
Otra persona? Aquí, aquí.
I've never seen anything like it. So far, we've got 28 pieces of cloth, and this is only the first part. We are now getting to the second lot. All these textiles belong to people of high social standing. They are decorated with divinities and ornithomorphic designs, that is to say, painted birds.
A total of 63 bundles of cloth are recovered that night by the archaeologists. It's the first time painted textiles have been found here. There are many unanswered questions. The textiles appear to be from different eras. Some are much, much older than others. Why would material from different periods be buried together? Analysis of the finds will take months of hard work.
We have to try to save all the information contained in the textiles. Many pieces have been darkened by organic material inside, and by the humidity they've been in contact with.
Only a very few such examples exist. Their scarcity is a question of age. The oldest textiles are from the beginning of Nazca civilization. Organic traces show that they have been in contact with corpses and were used as shrouds. Orofici concludes that they have been recovered, gathered into bundles, and ritually reburied, perhaps at a time of change in the religious or ceremonial practices. The mystery only adds to the fascination. These textiles will now be added to the laboratory museum. Even after so many centuries, Nazca art, cotton thread joining llama and alpaca-based wool craftsmanship, is sound. The unusual variety of colors and embroidery shine out under the Peruvian sun as if it were yesterday. This cotton and wool coat, decorated with a flying cat and a variety of Nazca religious figures, might have been part of the splendor of Cahuachi's ceremonies over 2,000 years ago. Even older, this funeral cloth, made up of seven strips and squares sewn together, might have covered the tomb of a woman who died 350 years before Christ. Sewn with cactus needles, these three-dimensional hummingbirds decorated the border of a ceremonial coat. The colors came from vegetable, animal, and insect pigments, such as crushed caterpillar fixed in human urine. This ceremonial costume is one of the jewels of the collection. On the central strip is a collection of Nazcan divinities. Around them, the people are in procession. Over 500 miniature figures, each one different, even down to their facial expressions. They carry flutes or maracas or fans. One can almost feel the Nazcas come to life with their painted faces and richly colored costumes, singing and dancing before their gods. The great city of Cahuachi lies deserted, hiding beneath a blanket of clay and sand. 1,700 years ago, after 6 centuries of uncontested domination, the Nazca's religious capital fell dramatically into oblivion, almost as if it had been buried alive.
What happened at Cahuachi? Between 300 and 350 AD, there were two important events. First, there was a major flood, which was particularly serious. We have found evidence of this in all of our excavations. Then there was an earthquake. An earthquake that would destroy all the temples. We found dead bodies under the walls which collapsed. The Nazca's religion no longer functioned. Their gods and ceremonial centers no longer functioned. It was then that they abandoned the city. But before they left, because everything was a ritual for them, the whole culture was based on religion. The Nazcas completely buried the ruins under piles of earth. Look at the remains on the highest part of the site, and you'll see that they are covered with a layer of clay that was brought to the top of the embankment by man. That's what makes this a sacred site. Everything, absolutely everything to be found under our feet was deliberately covered by the Nazcans themselves.
1700 years ago, the city of Cahuachi disappeared, buried by the very people who built it. The Nazcas would only survive their capital by another 200 or 300 years before they were assimilated by the Huari, an Andean people with whom they'd always interacted. Before the Inca, the Huari dominated all of Peru. The fall of Cahuachi led to the decline of its gods and the removal of the priest's power. As a feudal regime took shape, the old gods disappeared, and the faces of men began to appear on the ceramics. In the Nazca conscience, man was freed and would now occupy a more central position. The wind has dropped over the excavation site and work can begin again. In an intermediate layer between two phases of Cahuachi's history, the archaeologists have uncovered the mummy of a young llama. The animal has been sacrificed. This may be a tomb that has escaped the robbers. Next, a collection of pottery comes to the surface, revealing the presence of tombs. This pottery was used as covers for the funeral wells where the dead were buried. With lower limbs folded under the chin, the dead were buried in a fetal position, perhaps as a reminder of the origins of life, or because it was a comfortable position to be in for a long journey. A second tomb reveals a mummy still covered with its shroud. The archaeologists try to free it, but 15 centuries of immobilized waiting make the maneuver somewhat risky. The team's anthropologists decide to make an initial analysis in situ. Dr. Brian Harrison of the University of Oregon.
It's clearly the skeleton of a young woman. You can tell by the shape of the pelvis. She's an adult, but she's not very old, I think. I have not seen any arthritis on the joints. This excellent preservation of organic material here. This is a fantastic site. The hair is in perfect condition. We can get a lot of information about the population that lived here 1,000 years ago. One way we can tell that she was in good health is by the condition of her teeth. There's no lines. The enamel is very strong. So she was a healthy young woman, probably 20 to 25 years old. So the people we know were fairly short, long black hair, probably muscular from working very hard. And we have evidence from the skeletal materials, particularly the teeth, that they were very healthy people. And also from those same skeletons, we see no evidence of trauma. There was no warfare here.
After so long, such an encounter is a miracle. The body was buried without any particular preparation. Only natural mummification could have preserved the body in this way. The area's sand is rich in salts and nitrates, and without humidity. These mummies are a mine of information for anthropologists. Professor Andrea Drusini from the University of Padua has been able to study 550 individuals so far.
As with every population, we have come across various diseases: anemia, traces of malnutrition, children's illnesses, and other infectious diseases. According to statistics concerning this population, it can be said that their life expectancy was around 37-38 years. This is not significantly different than 19th century Europe, where the average lifespan was 42 years, and yet there is almost 2,000 years difference between the two populations.
Soon after work resumes on the site of the tombs, a new body appears. Unlike the others, it is lying on the ground in a horizontal position. Dr. Drusini now assumes the role of coroner. The skeleton's hands are tied in front of the body.
Questa posizione è molto inusuale.
Può essere naturale questa posizione?
No. Probabilmente si è trattato di un'esecuzione e il corpo poi è rimasto in questa posizione.
È piegato sotto la pancia. È molto strano questo.
Secondo me c'è stato un colpo molto forte che ha praticamente fratturato la base del cranio. Però dall'andamento della frattura sembra che sia stato inferto dal davanti e non dal dietro. Come quando è appoggiata la testa, capisci? Il collo si arqua.
Ma non è fuori dal suo posto?
No, no.
Frattura ben grande.
Ovviamente sarebbe stato un colpo proprio nella zona proprio del frontale,
il frontale
secco proprio qua.
Che ha fracassato completamente.
Ha fracassato completamente la parte.
Il setto nasale, il maxillo facciale.
Il facciale, naso. Ha fracassato proprio completamente la faccia.
Lo copriva completamente. Non è giovane?
No, ma è giovanissima.
35 anni.
40 anni.
Tiene anche 40 anni. Ah.
Coprolito.
Coprolito in bocca.
This is not the first time that coprolite or fossilized human excrement has been found here in the mummies' mouths. The meaning of such a practice, however, has not been determined.
In a case like this one, we don't know the meaning that placing excrement in an individual's mouth might have had. Perhaps it was a mark of disrespect or a punishment. We just don't know.
In total, 7 mummies are taken from their tombs that day, providing a much larger sample for the anthropologists to work on. The sample provides outsiders a view into another world, fascinating, yet very different from our own, and somewhat disturbing. Over 90% of the skulls studied by Professor Dracini were artificially deformed. This practice can be found in other civilizations and was probably based on certain concepts of beauty. For about a year, the heads of newborn babies were bound with tightly wrapped llama skin bindings, which forced their supple skulls to grow upwards. A short distance away in the laboratory, there are skulls with holes in the forehead, a real challenge to our imaginations. These are men's skulls, but women's and children's were also found this way, suggesting this was not a ritual of war. A rope through the hole held in place by a stick inside the skull would have allowed the heads to be carried or suspended, perhaps an offering and a sacrifice, a trophy, or a symbol of power. Sometimes the mouth is sewn up with a wooden needle or a cactus spine. Sometimes the eyes are blocked, or the tongue cut out and sewn into a little leather bag, so the dead souls cannot return to bother the living. All the iconography illustrates the importance of these practices in a civilization that was no more and no less barbaric than any other at that time.